The year is 1984 and Norway sent two confident girls to Luxembourg who tells the media that their song is the best composition ever and will easily push Herreys down in their golden shoes. Well, that didn't happen and the result was nothing else than meager for the Norwegian duo. What have happened since then and how many tries have Dollie de Luxe done to reach Eurovision Song Contest? Well, that and much more I hope to reveal today when I, Emil Löfström, have invited the beauty Benedicte Adrian with the powerful opera voice to Eurovision Legends. Welcome to Eurovision Legends, Benedicte Adrian.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. What a wonderful start of the program. I sound so cocky. Yeah, of course we wanted to win. Everybody wants to win. It's a competition, right?
Yeah. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. Yes, thank you.
Do you remember how you first came in contact with Eurovision Song Contest?
I remember being 10 years of age, standing in front of a television and watching ABBA sing Waterloo. One of the biggest days in my life. A huge dream was born. Yes, that was amazing.
Have you been an ABBA fan since?
Oh, yes. Completely ABBA fan since. I did actually see it before that, but that was a kind of a changing point. Mm.
You and Ingrid started to sing and play together when you were 12.
Yes.
When you were 16 years old, you released your first album.
Yeah, that's correct. We were next door neighbors, Ingrid, Bjornov and I. And we went to the same school. And then I moved to another area where our mothers had to keep us in contact. Because at my school, the mother of Ingrid was working. And my mother was a dentist at the school where Ingrid was still going. So we had to write little messages, give it to our mothers, and then we kept in contact just because we had something in common. We liked not to play with dolls. That was boring. We liked to do other kind of things, especially music, it turned out. So she would come to my place and stay over Friday night. We would then watch television, which at that time it ended at 11 o'clock in the evening. There was no more television to watch, so you had to do something else. So we would play organ and piano until 2 and 3 in the morning. I don't know how the neighbors coped. They were so nice. So this was our great passion and hobby. And of course, we dreamt of one day participating in the Eurovision Song Contest.
In 1981, the two of you took part in the national pre-selection in Norway with the song 1984.
Read in the book or seen the film 1984? It's no. George Orwell. Oh, you should.
Okay.
Oh, yes. It predicts a future where you're being seen by cameras everywhere and the state knows exactly what you're doing. And it's quite terrifying. And we're starting to move in that direction completely now.
Yeah.
So it was a warning. Yeah. But it's very strange that we did that song called 1984, and it turned out that it wasn't, as you probably know, in 1984 that we actually had the Norwegian flag on our chest, as we say.
Exactly. Mm. And I wonder, was this the first time you submitted a song to the national pre-selection?
Yes, it was. Mm. Yeah.
You performed the song under the name Dolly. You later changed it to Dollie de Luxe. Why did you change it?
To win the Eurovision, I guess. Which we never did. Well, we won the Norwegian one. We had a manager, and for one whole day, he kept saying, "Oh, but that's great. That's really deluxe." And then finally I said, "Haven't you noticed that I've said deluxe so many times today?" And we said, "Well, maybe you have." "Yeah, that's because I think you should change your names and put deluxe behind it to sort of show your audience that you're going for a bigger audience."
Yeah.
Okay, so we did. I mean, the name Dolly was just for fun anyway, because yeah. Our names were Ingrid and Benedicta. And we thought that that sounded like two girls with a piano and guitar singing acoustic. And we wanted to, well, to be more like ABBA, Kate Bush, Beatles. So we wanted to have a name that was more artistic. And now we added deluxe to it. And it was kind of just to show that we are here for fun. We are here to entertain. So we leave that for quite some years afterwards.
You came in sixth with 1984. And Finn Karlvik won.
Mm.
I wonder here, in retrospect, do you think your song would have ended up better than a last place with 0 points?
No, you know, in those days, Norway did not do very well in Eurovision. That was, I loved Finn Karlvik's song. It was produced by Benny Andersson, and the girls of ABBA were singing. So I just loved that song. Wasn't very happy when he got 0 points, but I thought he should just be proud of what he did, because I still love this song. Strange things happen in Eurovision, that's why it's so fun to watch. It's very seldom that it's the song that I like the best that actually wins. And even the year that we participated, I thought that Italy had the best song.
Yeah.
And we did like Herace and their song too. But I remember Hayray saying to us, "We believe that you're going to win." But it's all about also if you manage to reach your public. And in those days, in the 80s, early 80s, you were not allowed to sing in another language. We had to sing in Norwegian. But we managed to go to 7 different countries and try and make some publicity around ourselves before the final. And that was the countries that gave us the most of the votes. So it's more turned into a business now, where people are allowed to publish their work long way ahead of the grand finale, the big competition, because it's business also. It's reaching your public.
Yeah. The year after, in 1982, you took part again in the pre-selection. With the song "Det är det jag ska ha."
Ja. Ja, jag ler lite av den. Den var faktiskt väldigt mycket bättre i den demon som vi hade för, som hette Butterfly Fly. Den var väldigt fin, men när vi lagde den med norsk text så följde jag att den aldrig blev så väldigt bra. Rätt och slett.
Do you still have that demo?
No, I don't think so. Or maybe after our death we will find something somewhere. Fotvingen hör på mig, det här må du ta. Det är inte någon bön, det är där jag ska ha. Lätt i toner och i kupp och trimmer du av. Du har inte någon val, det här vi får bra.
Came 10 out of 10 with far less points than the other one.
Yep. So the year after we didn't try it again.
No, because I wonder here, the year after you didn't take part in the national pre-selection.
No.
And you didn't submit any songs at all.
No.
I saw a Norwegian interview yesterday on YouTube, and they said that you were not friends at all in 1983.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No, that's not right. But we've had periods where we wondered. I mean, I know that Ingrid found it in some periods very frustrating to sit with the piano and do playback. You know, it was very usual to do playback on television.
Yeah.
And if you're the singer, it doesn't bother you that much because you're up front and you have all the close-ups and you feel you're performing anyway, you're doing your stuff. But for Ingrid, sitting by the piano, and often they wouldn't even put a... It was just there with no wire, no nothing, and no sound. So it felt completely stupid to sit there and play on these plastics and not doing your thing. So yeah. She was very frustrated, but decided in 84 that she would give it a go again anyway. But we've always been friends, even though we've been sometimes irritating each other, like all friends do.
Yeah. In 1984, you were back in the national pre-selection with the song Länge leve livet.
Yeah.
This is the only song you submitted this year.
I know what you want. How? You read your story very well, because we actually we were on Swedish television also with a song called Wanted Dead or Alive.
Yeah.
And we did present it. Oh, you know our history, because very few people know this. We actually had a meeting in Luxembourg with the producer there. Because we knew that in Luxembourg and in Switzerland, they didn't have a competition like in all the other countries. It was the producer that decided which song was going to represent their country. So we knew that we could maybe represent Luxembourg in doing Wanted Dead or Alive. And we thought that that was a really good song. We felt the disadvantage of having to sing in Norwegian was so... It was so hard to ever dream about winning the Eurovision because nobody liked our language. That was the feeling we had at that time. And so we did have a meeting with the producer and he said, well, we've just decided to go for another song with another young girl. You should have come a little bit earlier. Which is good. I'm so glad we didn't sing for Luxembourg. No. Yes, so happily we didn't do that.
And for those who wonder how Wanted sound, I will play it here. Very ABBA.
Yes, it is very ABBA. So we loved it. we loved the way it was recorded, and we'd worked in Stockholm with a very good Swedish musician, Kjell Löfbom.
I know him.
He was producing things for us.
Mm. Yeah, he were in Europe, and I know him because I cut his wife's hair.
Pia Löfbom. Oh, really?
The world is so small.
But anyway, I'm so glad that we didn't do something as stupid as to represent another country because we are Norwegians and we should do it for Norway. But we wanted to win for Norway.
What do you remember from the national final at Chateau Neuf in Oslo?
I remember thinking, we did it. I wasn't sure that I was ever going to win this thing. It was like going to a fun fair and you have the biggest bear and it's pink and it's for you and you won it in a lottery.
Yeah.
It felt strange. When a dream comes true, it's a very strange feeling. Because this was our dream.
You won with 2 points over Beate Jakobsen and her song yeah. Strand Hotel.
Mm-hmm. That's the way it is in this competition. I mean, even ABBA, I don't think, won with very many points.
Exactly.
So yeah. Mm. As long as you win, you win.
I have read that you said to the media that you definitely had the best song in Luxembourg and easily would beat Therese from Sweden. Can you elaborate this?
Oh, my God. Well, okay. I think we were really told, if I can remember it right, that our producer and manager said, we must stop coming from Norway and saying, excuse us, we're no good. All the others are so much better. Because like he says, people will always find something wrong about you and what you're doing. So you should not help them to find those things. And he said, it's much better to come and be confident. And then maybe people can even think the thought that maybe you're good, because he felt that especially Norwegian artists were too well had a lack of self confidence. So, but I'm it makes me laugh now because okay, I still think that Italy had the best song that year. I still do our song sometimes, Länge leve livet. So I think we did something credible and something within our style, which represented us, and that we can live well with that later, which yeah. is good.
So you went to Luxembourg to win.
Of course we went to win. Everybody did, except that in Norway at that time it was the most important thing was to do better than Sweden. And Sweden won. So we didn't even manage to do better than Sweden. No, this was lousy results. But the song is still quite good, I think. I think it's one of our best songs.
You had some epic dance moves that looked like telemark skiing.
Yeah. Yes, we never agreed exactly on how those moves should be. So if you look carefully, we're not doing it exactly the same either. We spent money on the costumes that year, but not on a choreographer. So...
And we also remember some red strings in your hair and a kind of Japanese style of your clothes.
Yeah. Yes. We were so fascinated by Japan. And we'd been to Japan in 82 to release an album. We released 2 albums there. And it was kind of fashion also at that time with other bands also. Like the song Big in Japan was very big in Europe.
And those red strings in your hair were later changed to pearls, I noticed when I watched some later performances. And for those who haven't seen this, would it be correct to describe you as the love child between Marie Antoinette and Nina Hagen?
Yeah, yes. Yes, that'd be correct. That's beautiful. Mm. And I thought I was going to wear these things, filler, as we call it, traces, laces in our head. We thought we were going to wear that forever.
Yeah.
I really, really believed that I was going to use that forever. But no, it was quite hard to sleep on them and you had to take them out and put them in. And it was work, but it was worth it. It was worth it. It looked fabulous.
Did you do it by yourself or did you have any hairstylist?
Oh, we did most things ourselves. So we did it ourselves, yeah.
What are your memories from Luxembourg?
I don't remember that much from Luxembourg. I remember we had lots of interviews every day. And that was very useful because then we could reach our audience in different countries. And those were the ones that voted for us. It was hard work. Yeah. I remember also being extremely nervous, going on stage and kind of having this out of your body experience almost, because it's very intense. I remember we were fighting, trying to get more close-ups, because it's very important to have close-ups in this show. If you are filmed from a far distance, you look small and people don't get to see your expressions, your facial expressions. So we could see that this was a fight with the producer to try and get them interested in your act and have them get you the close-ups. I remember that Denmark had a
No, not that song. They had Dollie de Luxe.
Okay. No, I'm...
Ska du spöra från någon what was in 85?
No. How strange my memory is. I remember... Yes, I remember... Ich hau von jou. I lean von jou. That was the Netherlands, very beautiful girl with lots of close-ups and a beautiful song. And even though the language was quite something you could not understand, you could understand Ik hou van jou or something like that, which means I love you.
Yeah.
That was great. That was a great song also. And of course, I remember her race. They were so sweet. And I still know how to move my arms like them. because Rickard told me, I mean, we were hanging out a little bit with them because they were so nice. So that was, of course, it won because it was a good song. It made you happy. It's a little bit in a blur, really, because you're so focused on your song.
Funny you say this, because I talked to Kit Rolf from Bell and the Devotions, and she told me exactly the same. It was a blur.
Mm. You're so nervous, and you're so hardworking all the time, trying to reach your audience, so you cannot sit back and just watch the show.
Yeah.
And you're always wondering, I mean, I remember now the three English girls. And I was thinking, I'm so impressed because they managed not to smile for the week on end. And I was wondering if that was more cool. Maybe the audience would find that more cool to be like that. Well, we were not like that. and you're also wondering... when you see all the costumes, I mean, it is a competition and you really want to be at your best. So, but you have to concentrate on just being you and doing your thing so that you can live with that afterwards, no matter the results. And that was what we did. And it served us quite well. But later it has been a positive thing and also a negative thing sometimes, this Eurovision thing. It can be a little bit of a curse afterwards. I'm very happy that it's a positive thing to do it now. Even Andrew Lloyd Webber did it some years.
My time is my time.
like that, because it was a period in our life when that kind of did not do some good work for us, when we wanted to kind of work with what you call more serious music.
Yeah.
When we were writing a musical and producing it in London. And that was not something you would easily talk about then and say that, yeah, we even did the Eurovision. Oh, no, that's not good.
Luxembourg had big problems this year with hotel rooms for all visitors and delegations. And the Grand Theatre of Luxembourg had only 950 seats. So the press had to watch the competition from their hotel rooms, if they had any. I want to hear, did you have any problems with hotel rooms, or did you feel, let's go to Luxembourg and do some camping?
I've never done camping in my whole life. You know, we did get our rooms, I remember that. But I also remember that the theatre was kind of cold. Yeah. It wasn't wild as it is now. It's kind of remembering it in black and white and not in colour. Now it's really more colourful. So, okay. I do remember it kind of strict.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sweden won, as we said, has said so many times now, with the three brothers in golden shoes.
Yeah.
And Norway only ended up in 17th place out of 19 participants.
Yes, it was really bad as usual, just up until that point, yeah. So, yes, what can one say? It's a competition. You just do your best. And I don't know. I just don't think we could have done it differently. I think we did it the way we should anyway.
You and Ingrid continued your duo after this meager result with more album releases and achieved very good critic and sales both in Norway and abroad. Later on, you put up a musical called Witch Witch, and during that time, you were both praised and criticized for your music.
Yeah, we were even banned at the Protestant TV station in the Netherlands because we were mixing Mozart and classical music with rock, and some people found that very offensive.
Yeah.
But we said after the Eurovision, we said, no, let's do something else now. Let's not try to be popular. Let's try just to do fun stuff that we want to do. We will start with opera and rock. And we said that kind of as a joke, but also thinking that, that'll be interesting. Because I'd taken singing lessons from the age of 15, and that was for classical singing. So I was singing the Queen of the Night's aria at the press conference in Luxembourg also. And we saw that if we wanted the press attention, it was better for us to do that than anything else that we could do. So we were having lots of fun doing a project that we called Rock versus Opera, where Ingrid were making the arrangements. And with my singing teacher, we were finding lots of nice classical material, which sounds kind of like pop music to our ears still today. I think it's nice music for people who think they maybe don't like classical music. And if they listen to rock versus opera, they may decide otherwise afterwards. Whatever you want. And the Witch Witch in London, that was something completely different. Yeah. But we wanted to also there mix opera singing with wild electric guitars and to kind of make rock, really rock and opera meet, but this time it was our own music, our own songs. It's been quite a journey.
You have released 8 full-length albums together. Do you have any favorite songs from them?
It depends on my mood. Well, if you want to play something from which kind of shows the style, then Eternally is a good song.
Yeah, that's my favorite.
Good. So you shadow in my head, I find a shadow unto me. By day or night I shall remain, before the triple God is free. I find a shadow unto me, may the mother head count. Dawn and noon and night may see free, all is bound to me, and you are mine eternally.
In my opinion, it sounds very much like a mix between the Swedish group One More Time and the musical Chess.
Oh yeah, but we love Chess also. We went to London to see it. And We were certainly made of that kind of stuff. That's how we've learned to write music. That's for listening to these great musicians like Björn and Benny.
Does Dollie de Luxe still exist?
Dollie de Luxe was never dead. We never split up the group, but we still did it without saying it so much. So Ingrid and I, we are still very good friends, and we're working each on our thing. I think maybe one day we will do something together again. But that day is not yet come. We haven't decided when or what we're going to do. But so for now, Dollie de Luxe is sleeping, I think. Like Tornerose, like in the fairy tales, sleeping for 100 years, maybe a little bit less than 100 years.
Have you submitted any more songs to the national pre-selection since 1984?
I hoped you were not going to ask. Yes, there are some secrets around there.
Okay. Yes, we keep them in here then.
Yeah.
What are you doing today, Benedicta?
Well, today I'm working on a new project with 10 new songs. I write both the songs and the lyrics, so I'm fighting a little bit with the last lyrics now because I'm writing in Norwegian and I want to present it with a cello and a piano. And I want it to have a sound a little bit like old Beatles songs versus Sigrid, if you know the Norwegian artist Sigrid.
Yes.
When I don't know what to say, when I don't know what to do, there's a room I need to sit in, surrounded by my favorite view, and I need a hand to hold, someone to tell the truth. Would it be okay if I came home to you? She's fantastic. So I'm trying to find this kind of a little bit new sound of kind of pop music, not opera this time at all. So I'm trying also to break a little bit new ground if possible, find ways to combine classical way of thinking with pop music.
I'm looking forward to hear about this.
Thank you.
Before we end this conversation, I have to mention a Swedish friend of mine who was 10 years old in 1984 and was so upset when Herreys won, so he started to cry. He later joined your fan club and wants to send his good wishes to you.
Are you kidding? How sweet. Oh, yes. Yes. Wonderful. What's this guy's name?
His name is Roger Lundgren, and he is working as a royal expert in Sweden with the royal family.
Wow, tell him I want to come and sing for the royal family. Oh, that's great. That's wonderful. We love touring in Sweden also. But that's wonderful to hear. Wonderful to hear. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Benedicta, for this. It's been a delight.
Thank you. Delight is for me. Thank you. Thank you.
And also thanks to you, all listeners out there. I hope that you enjoyed this episode. And if you did, consider subscribing to Eurovision Legends on any of the podcast platforms, spreading the word to your friends and perhaps writing a review. You can contact me with suggestions, questions, opinions, or whatever you feel like by emailing me at emil@schlagervandrarna.se or through our social media on Instagram and Facebook. Have a nice time, and you'll hear from me again soon with a new legend from the world of Eurovision. Stor klem da, Benedikte!
Ah, tusen takk! Stor klem tilbake!
Ha det morsomt ut på tur!
Så bra! Du pratar norska. Det var jävligt bra faktiskt. Ja, tack ska du ha!